بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
بالصلاة تطيب لي الحياة وأرضي بها الإله، يحلو الوصال راحتي، إن ضاقت كربتي توجهت لقبلتي.
Perhaps the dirt in our hearts needs to be cleaned. The remnants of the period of ignorance that is in our heart needs to be cleaned. We need to be following Islam. The service to Islam today is actually done by those who say they follow Islam when they are not following Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala use us to spread a good message. And may we be such that we live Islam in a way that those who are not Muslim can actually see Islam in the true sense within us. They see the contentment we have.
And keep me true, loving and praising you.
Allahu Akbar at the top of Universal Peace. Please put it on down.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل يا عبادي الذين أسرفوا على أنفسهم لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله، إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا، إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. وأنيبوا إلى ربكم وأسلموا له من قبل أن يأتيكم العذاب ثم لا تنصرون. واتبعوا أحسن ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم من قبل أن يأتيكم العذاب بغتة وأنتم لا تشعرون. أن تقول نفس يا حسرة على ما فرطت في جنب الله وإن كنت لمن الساخرين. أو تقول لو أن الله هداني لكنت من المتقين. أو تقول حين ترى العذاب لو أن لي كرة فأكون من المحسنين. بلى قد جاءتك آياتي فكذبت بها واستكبرت وكنت من الكافرين. ويوم القيامة ترى الذين كذبوا على الله وجوههم مسودة، أليس في جهنم مثوى للمتكبرين. وينجي الله الذين اتقوا بمفازتهم لا يمسهم السوء ولا هم يحزنون.
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على عبد الله ورسوله محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We commence by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sending blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was sent as a mercy to mankind and to creation at large. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless him and his entire household, those who supported him from the very beginning. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless them and all the companions, and may he bless every single one of us. Brothers and sisters, I commence with a prayer of mercy for those aboard The flight MH370, we ask Allah to have mercy on them, to have mercy on their families, to have mercy on us, to have mercy on the nation, and to have mercy on humanity at large. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept this prayer of ours, and may He make us from amongst those really whom, whenever we call out to Him, He answers our prayer. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless every single one of us. Brothers and sisters, we all are searching for peace, and we would all love to see peace. There are people who use religion in order to create warfare, whereas Islam has come about with peace. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's entire lifestyle and all the moments that he spent on this earth were enshrined in the words of peace. The goodness that he taught, everything pointed towards peace, so much so that the word Islam itself means peace. So why then would we engage in warfare? And why then would we be looked at as people who love to cause problems or to create disasters or to become terroristic, whereby innocent civilians or innocent people are killed, and all this in the name of the religion? And this is why we are here, to confirm that Islam is actually the religion of peace. Wherever Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam found the opportunity to spread the word of peace, even with the enemy, he spread it. And this is why, when it comes to those who are outright enemies, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it very clear that we need to strike a deal with them. Look at the Treaty of Hudaybiyah that was struck just on the outskirts of Makkah al-Mukarramah, the sixth year of Hijrah, where Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, against all odds, signed a treaty that was actually biased against the Muslims, because there was peace that was at stake. And in order not to lose that peace, he signed it. When they had the document, they decided to take out Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, in the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. They said, remove this, take it out. The Sahaba were reluctant to do this. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no, remove it. Why? Because there is peace at stake here. Take it out, no problem. When they wrote Muhammad Rasulullah, the kuffar of Quraysh said, no, take out the term Rasulullah. We don't believe that he is Rasulullah. You write Muhammad ibn Abdullah. The Sahaba again were upset. They were reluctant to do this. But what he said, no problem. Take out the term Rasulullah, because there is peace at stake. We don't want to lose the peace. This is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They said that if anyone from amongst us comes to you in Medina, send him back to us. But if anyone from you comes to us, we are not going to send him back to you. It is unfair. Imagine if I say, your people come to me, I send them back. My people come to you, they don't go back. That is unfair. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no problem, we will agree with that. For 10 years we will have complete peace. He said, we will agree with that. So against all odds, he said, let's agree. And the agreement was struck by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we take a careful look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, even regarding the enemies at war with the Muslimin, وَإِن جَنَحُوا لِلسَّلْمِ فَجْنَحْ لَهَا وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. If they are inclining towards peace, then you incline completely towards it. If they are trying to make peace with you, make sure that you make peace with them and lay your trust in Allah. Why did Allah say lay your trust in Allah? Because sometimes we become people who are reluctant when we are doubting the intention of the next man. We are reluctant to make peace. My brothers and sisters, here we are talking of warfare, where Islam says that we should avoid it as far as possible. Avoid it and make sure that even if the real enemy wants to make peace with you, go and make peace with them. And if you are not so certain of their intentions, remember, lay your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tawakkal ala Allah. This is why immediately after Allah says, incline towards peace even more than their inclination towards peace, He says, lay your trust in Allah. Because if you are not certain of their intentions, Allah knows their intentions, and Allah will protect you if they intend to harm you. The problem we have in our own homes, within our own communities, within those who call themselves Muslimin, we find people not prepared to make peace. Not even in our own houses sometimes, amongst the in-laws, amongst the wives and children, amongst the wives of the brothers or perhaps the brothers and so on. We know that sometimes there is disaster, no peace. The reason is we have not learned from the real example where Allah says, those who are outright enemies, make peace with them. What about those who are your brothers and sisters in reality or your brothers and sisters in faith? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. This evening we got news of a group of people in Nigeria calling themselves Muslimin, going around killing sporadically. This is absolutely absurd. It is the furthest away from Islam. It is not connected to this religion in any way. It is actually chaotic, and it is about time we spoke about it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from such deviance in our own thoughts. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to understand that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with a message of peace, a message of tolerance, a message of understanding. For so many years we've had so much of goodness. Why is it that today the mind is being hijacked by those who have a misunderstanding of the religion? Protect yourselves from it. This is why we are taught as Muslimin, if anyone speaks to you in a way that they are inciting your insides to become a violent person, remember that is not part of the faith. It is not part of the deen. You need to understand what they are preaching is something political. Perhaps they have another agenda. They are trying to use myself and yourselves and others who may be slightly ignorant and con us. Nay, we will be those who are knowledgeable, not conned at all. We will stand against it and we will promote peace against all odds. My brothers and sisters, it's important for us to realize that the peace that was at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was achieved by justice. Because he was fair in his own home, there was peace. Because he was just with his own people, there was peace. They relied on what he said. They knew him as the truthful and the honest from the very beginning, even prior to the advent of Islam, meaning prior to prophethood. They already knew him as a person who was trustworthy and honest. When they had a problem, when the kuffar of Quraysh had a problem whilst rebuilding the Kaaba, and they all wanted the honor of lifting up the black stone in order to place it in the corner that it's supposed to be after the renovation and rebuilding of the Kaaba, there was a dispute. In that dispute, all the different tribes were saying, do you know what? We would like to have the honor of doing it. So they decided, okay, the next man to walk in here will be the one who will decide what will happen. Lo and behold, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam walked in. They were all delighted. They knew that this man, this was before he was even a prophet, this man, whatever he says, will be fair and just. Do you know what he did? In order to maintain peace, and in order to promote that peace, and in order to ensure that there are no squabbles and there is no fighting, and this was before Islam, imagine, he took a cloth, he laid the cloth, he got one leader from all of those tribes and told them, you catch a little bit of that cloth. So they were on the corners and on the side, and he took the black stone and put it on the cloth. They all lifted it up and they all walked with it. So it was not seen as any one individual carrying that stone, but everyone would say, we collectively lifted the stone. And then what happened? When they got to the corner where the Kaaba, where it was supposed to be placed, he lifted it once again and put it into its place. And thereby the problem was solved, resolved completely, such that peace prevailed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. From this, we learn that although it was prior to Islam, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's companions spoke about it even after Islam, in a way that would definitely teach us that to protect ourselves from some form of predicted harm or predicted problem is actually an act of worship. So if you are foreseeing a bit of disunity, think very quickly of how you can save yourself from that disunity in order to protect the nation and the ummah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. Today we have the nation that we are in. We have the ummah that we belong to. Both, it is our duty to ensure the peace and stability of our nation as well as the ummah of Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala use us to promote this peace and to promote the true message of Islam. My brothers and sisters, take a look at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He dealt with the qualities of the heart in order to eradicate the initial seed of dissent that might be sown in the hearts of people, which will then result in disunity and a split based on jealousy and hatred, and thereafter enmity and war. So this is why jealousy prohibited in Islam. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has stressed very strongly the issue of protecting yourself and myself from jealousy. Why? Because that is the root, that is the seed of dissent that will grow, and it grows into a wild tree with a huge bark that has its roots very deep, which becomes very hard to chop off. So he says, do not even sow that seed from the very beginning. Don't be jealous of what Allah has blessed some of you above the others in any way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to become happy upon the happiness of others. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to become happy when we see our brothers and sisters having moved beyond our own expectations and beyond what we were ever able to do in our own lives. It is only when we support such people that we will be able to progress as an ummah. But if we were to become jealous of anyone who excels above us, it means we have set a bar according to our capacity, our acceptance, our capability, and we would not like anyone to go beyond that bar. If that is the case, how do you expect the ummah to develop? How do you expect your nation to develop? If a person has, for example, done very well in their secondary examination and they receive 10 A's, 11 A's, and they say, if anyone gets 12, just cut out the one, make sure it's not, it never ever reaches 12. If that's the case, it is fraud. It is jealousy to the degree that it would be considered the height of corruption if that happened. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. So jealousy prohibited. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّ الْحَسَدَ يَأْكُلُ الْحَسَنَاتِ كَمَا تَأْكُلُ النَّارُ الْحَطَبِ. In order to promote peace, he has definitely said that hasad and jealousy eats away even the other good deeds that you have done, in the same way that the fire would eat away at a dry log. What this means is, you can be reading your salah, you can be dressed appropriately, you can be reading Quran, you can be fasting, you can have gone for Hajj, you can have been giving so much zakah, but if you have jealousy in your heart, you have wasted your time. All those deeds are gone. Why? Because this is the root of peace, to protect your heart from dirty qualities. And this is when peace will be beaming across the globe. We become jealous because we have a difference of opinion with someone, and the other person's opinion happens to be more accepted. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from jealousy. Yes, we may want to discuss matters. It is important. Constructive criticism is also that which is called for. Discussion of how to be able to improve. Someone may not accept my opinion, but if they come up with a better opinion, I need to lower myself and accept it, because the opinion is more valid than mine, or perhaps will be more productive than mine. That is part of my Islamic duty. To be humble enough to acknowledge that someone has a better opinion than mine. Sometimes we have a problem where we feel we are the only ones who are right. The way I do things in my house, I am the boss. And if I am the boss, then that's it. Nobody is allowed to say anything or do anything that is against what I say or do. Subhanallah. If that is the case, can we really call ourselves Muslimin when we know that some of what we've said is actually wrong because we are human beings, or some of what we have said is probably inferior to some of what the other people have said? We need to acknowledge. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness, and may He grant us a deeper understanding of the deen. My brothers and sisters, it is important to go through the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Take a look at the disputes that he has resolved, what he has solved by the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why, like I say, Islam means peace. We stand for peace, we live by peace, we promote peace, we teach peace, we would like to see peace, and we want to see peace in our children and offspring and the generations to come. Why is it that what we are seeing is not peace, but pieces? Allahu Akbar. Rather than peace, perhaps we misspell it and it becomes pieces. We're creating little bits and pieces, Allahu Akbar. Whereas peace itself is depicted in the unity that we have, the togetherness that we have. When we say unity, it does not mean I have to think exactly like you to be united with you. But what it does mean is, I appreciate that you are my brother or sister in the deen, and I feel for your feeling. Subhanallah. Take a look at the aircraft that has gone missing. Don't we all feel, don't we all have this feeling across the globe that something has happened that has hurt us, that we are concerned about, that we would like to see a good outcome regarding? But tell me something, the bulk of us do not have blood relations there, but we feel it just as much because we are part and parcel of that larger family. We have humanity within us, and we have the deen within us, and we have the beautiful teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam within us. He showed similar concern to humanitarian crises. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. So much so that he showed concern to animals as well. That he has made mention of how those who have perhaps quenched the thirst of a dog or assisted a hungry cat have earned paradise as a result, even though their deeds may not have been that grand. Allahu Akbar, because it's the heart that counted. And it is the reaching out to the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is enshrined in Islam that actually was depicted within those actions. And that is what resulted in these people earning paradise. Today, forget about reaching out to animals. We don't even reach out to our family members. We do not reach out to our community members. There are people in our midst who are sick and ill. Do you know that it is the teaching of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to promote the sense of belonging and to promote peace and to promote that sense of identity as an ummah to visit the sick, to go out and pray for them, to make sure that we visit them and we say, Ya Allah, grant this person cure, to give them a few words of comfort, to make them feel that definitely they will come out of their sickness. Let's ask ourselves, how many of us have visited the ill Muslimin who are not related to us? Some of us might be thinking, well, even those related to us, we have not yet visited them. Well, there you are. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to be true Muslimin. Today we are struggling with the image of Islam across the globe, not because there is something wrong with Islam, but there is something wrong with the Muslimin. This is the problem. And this is why we say we need to reintroduce Islam in our lives. The proper Islam, the true Islam, that which when we follow it, we have internal and external peace. Believe me, if you are a true Muslim, true to your word, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will be a person who will never ever be upset or lose contentment. You will always be a happy person, content with you, what Allah has chosen for you. Yet you are working towards what you feel is beneficial within the capacity that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided you. And this is Islam. But the problem, and it's a very big problem, where we have started taking things in our own hands. And we begin to become individuals rather than a collective family of the ummah. And we do not show concern for someone. If a sister, for example, and I encourage all my sisters to ensure that their dress code is correct. But the example I'm about to give, if one of our sisters happens to have a dress code that is not so correct, it does not mean that now they are no longer part of us and we should not be greeting them and we should not be letting them feel that they are part of our family. Sometimes in our own children and sometimes in ourselves, we will find sins here and there that we are not proud of. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us from those who think that just because it's an open sin that we need to disassociate ourselves from our own brothers and sisters. Remember, be kind, keep reaching out. A day will come when they too will turn towards the message of peace distributed or issued by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The same applies to the brothers. I recall very clearly, there was a certain man who was a drunkard. A certain man who was a drunkard. And I kept talking to him and reaching out to him, even at the point of his drunkard state. I would go to him and I would talk to him. This is a real example. And I would explain to him, look, what you've done is very bad. And because of his respect for me, he used to say, let us read Salah, but he was drunk. And so what I would do is, I would say, okay, now I know that the Quran says, لا تقربوا الصلاة وأنتم سكارى. But my idea was not that he fulfills Salah, because that Salah would not be valid in that condition, but to get him to wash himself with cold water so some of his intoxication can actually disappear. So he washes himself with cold water and he says, oh Allah, you are the greatest. Oh Allah, you are the greatest. And he keeps repeating this. Wallahi, a few years later, he met me and he told me, do you know what, my son? He was an elderly man. He says, I have cut the habit and it's been 2 years and I don't even drink. And yet he had this habit for a few decades. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. Had we treated that man according to our own whims and fancies, we would have said, drunkard, a'udhu billah, jahannam, he's going to hell, he's got no hope in anything, and just go away from him. You know, he's supposed to be lashed. We're supposed to take a whip and beat him up, and so on. If that was the case, was there ever any hope of this man coming back, seeing the path? We live in an environment where sometimes, subhanallah, Allah has covered people. And sometimes we live in non-Muslim countries, in some of us, where we cannot just take the law into our own hands. We can never ever take the law into our own hands. That too is a prohibition. Because you know, in order to implement the Sharia, you need to have the authority. And you need to have the permission, the authority to do that. If you don't have the authority, you cannot implement the laws, or should I say the hudud, which means the penal code of the Sharia. You cannot. That is part and parcel of knowledge. The problem is half-baked. We don't even know that. So now, someone commits adultery, and we're sitting in the corner of a house saying, come here, we want to lash you. But brother, you need a lash first because you've done this and that, that these people perhaps don't even know about. May Allah protect us. You cannot take the law in your own hands. Never. You need to understand, when we live in nations that are non-Muslim countries, subhanallah, we should realize and understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us opportunities to turn to Him far greater than had the Sharia been implemented with its penal code. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. May He grant us the understanding. So it is important for us to realize that the way we treat those who might be slightly distant in a way from the deen should be the same treatment of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had he been here. Subhanallah. And if he was here, mercy to mankind, what would he have done? Imagine, I want to ask you one simple question. It shows you the peace in Islam. I want to ask you a serious question. I saw today one of the most beautiful masjids that I've seen in a long time, mashallah. Bandaraya, down the road. I'm sure you know, it's the floating masjid in the water. Beautiful. I actually stopped the vehicle, jumped out, took some photographs, and tweeted them for the world to see. Subhanallah, what a beautiful place. Imagine someone walks into that masjid and suddenly zips up, opens his zip, and urinates on the carpet. Did you hear what I said? Imagine someone walks into the masjid and suddenly he wants to urinate, so he sits down on the carpet or standing, whatever it is, by one of the beautiful pillars, and he starts his business. Can you imagine that? Can anyone here picture that? To be honest with you, what would you do if you were standing right next to him? What would you do? It's such a difficult question. Because we don't realize, had Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam been here, he would have done something. Not only that, it happened in front of him and he did something. Let's listen to what happened. There was this Bedouin man who walked into Masjid Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not just Bandaraya, something 1,000 times better. Masjid Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the place where we all yearn to go, subhanallah. The place where we all love to go. May Allah take us there again and again. Say Ameen. And a man walked in and he decides, you know what? I need to pee. So, however he did it, he just, little corner, started peeing. Allahu Akbar. May Allah protect us. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum got up. I would guess just like we would. And they immediately wanted to pounce on him. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent as rahmah to mankind, rahmah to jinnkind, rahmah to the worlds. Do you know what happened? Immediately he stopped them. La tazmuru. Do not stop this man. Leave it. Let him do his business. A few months ago, I gave a lecture. And I actually said, that is such a great mercy. It is such great mercy to tell the people, let him finish. Oh, subhanallah. That means he was halfway still. He was carrying on. Subhanallah, the puddle was getting bigger. Allah protect us. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling them, leave him. Do you know why? That is a source of peace. The pee, we can wash it out. But if he stops his pee halfway, he probably will get so sick and ill that he might have disease or whatever else. I don't want to ask you to try stopping your pee halfway and seeing if you can do it or not. Because to be honest with you, it will create a disaster. Allahu Akbar. Do you want to know something very funny? The last time I said this, and I said, I wonder what it would feel like to cut your pee halfway. Imagine you're peeing and someone says, stop! And you say, I don't know how we would stop. Do you know what happened? The next day I received an email from someone saying, I tried it. It was very hard. I was shocked. I was shocked. I hope nobody tries it, because I don't want to receive emails to say I tried it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Because the point we're making here is, look at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, considerate of one man. Why? Let me inform you. Had they pounced on him and penalized him and kicked him out and made him do this and that, that was going to be one seed of dissent. The one seed of dissent would have grown into a whole tree with a huge trunk of hatred, opposition, such a negative way, that which is destructive, that which will continue to pick on even those things that are right, solely because it was attacked one day. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a lesson from it. So what happened? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent them away. Why did he send them away? He made the instruction, or he issued the instruction saying, go and get some water, a bucket of water, and bring it. When they went away, he seized the opportunity to quietly talk to this man and to explain to him something. Subhanallah. Now, if it was us, let alone getting angry and excited, picking up this person, beating him up black and blue until maybe the policeman came, and you know, if that policeman happened to be a person who was regular for salah, one wonders what he would then do to the same person, and so on. So we don't even know. But all that aside, even admonishing was done in private. You know, with our children, when we want to correct them, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all. Whether it's your wife, your husband, your family member, or anyone else, you want to correct them, the best way of doing it is in private, privately, quietly. Do not let other people see you telling your wife, you know what you did was very bad. Keep those words for when your door is closed. Give her two kisses, and on that day, maybe three. Then you tell her, you know what happened there? Was not so grand, you know, subhanallah, Allahu Akbar. You'll see, she'll give you a fourth one and a fifth one and say, thank you, love. Allahu Akbar. Now we're talking peace, isn't it? MashaAllah. But if you want war, try correcting her in public. Go to the mall, and as you're picking from the aisle, say, hey, why did you do this? And everyone turns around to see what you're doing, and you just say, it's me, you know? Allahu Akbar, may Allah safeguard us. That attitude will never bring about peace. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us peace in the home with the family members. And he told us, khayrukum khayrukum li ahli. The best from amongst you are those who are the best to their spouses, their family members. And then he goes on to say, and I am the best from amongst you to the family, to my own spouses. Subhanallah. Imagine. So that is to maintain peace. The reason why I'm talking about the family, and I've diverted a little bit to say about the family, is because that is the root. If the family is corrupt, society will be corrupt. If society is corrupt, the nation is over. And if the nation is over, then you cannot expect global peace. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the core that is filled with love and peace. Because that is the sense of belonging that will then give you the greater sense of belonging to the community. And from there, as a nation, you feel really gelled together, bonded together, such that if anything happens to one person, we all feel it. Do you know? The hadith says, "Al-mu'minuna kal-jasad al-wahidi, idha ishtaka minhu 'udhu, tada'a lahu sa'iru al-jasad bis-sahri wal-humma." The mu'minun, the true believers, they are like one family. They are like one body. The hadith says they are like one body. If a small part of it is hurting, the entire body feels the pain. Imagine if your little baby finger has been pricked by a thorn. You feel the pain, you cannot sleep, it starts swelling, you need to have tablets from your mouth, your eye looks at it, and your mouth will speak to the doctor, your feet will start walking in a certain direction. So you've helped the one little hurt that is on your perhaps baby finger in such a way that your whole body was used in order to alleviate that suffering. Today we are causing suffering within the ummah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. But it soothes the heart to see that there is still a bit of humanity, subhanallah, where we feel for our brothers and sisters on this particular aircraft that has just been lost. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really grant us the ability to use this opportunity to get together as an ummah and to regain that humanity that we have within us. And may the lesson from this be far greater than what has happened. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon all. Ameen. Really, the reason why I keep repeating it, it's right here. It is so fresh. It is as though it happened to me, subhanallah. And I'm sure we feel the same. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. Today, we flew on Malaysian Airlines coming through. And really, I made a prayer to Allah, Ya Allah, grant protection to us all and even to those whom we don't know what has happened to them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us this feeling even when we are in pain of a different nature. Even when we are in pain of a different nature. I plead with you husbands out there who are making your wives struggle. Remember, it is your duty to make her feel that sense of belonging. And it is your duty to ensure that she is a happy person, and vice versa. The wives also, it is your duty to ensure that your husbands are happy, they are good. We've got to be slightly more easygoing than we actually are. Sometimes we become difficult, and difficulty, when we become difficult, we actually would be inclining towards war rather than peace. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. So get back to this hadith that we were talking about. When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam corrected this man, and he told him, Do you know? This is the house of Allah. It is actually for reading your salah. It is actually for, meaning for praying. It is actually for reading Quran. It is for the remembrance of Allah and so on and so on. And it is not for this type of thing. It is not fit for this type of thing. So the man was so touched because he was saved. Basically, he was saved from a whole group of people who were about to pounce at him. So he says, Allahumma arhamni. Oh Allah, have mercy on me. Oh, that's a good dua. May Allah grant it to all of us. He says, Allahumma arhamni. And then he says, Warham Muhammadan. And oh Allah, have mercy on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wala tarham ma'ana ahadan. And oh Allah, don't have mercy on anyone else. Allahu Akbar. Imagine the dua. Now that created another disaster, because the dua, he because of the people having pounced on him, or wanting to pounce on him, he felt, hey, this was such a beautiful explanation. So he made dua for himself, mercy, Allah have mercy on me. Oh Allah have mercy on Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but don't have mercy on anyone. So Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam once again corrected him in a beautiful way. He says, you have tried to make narrow something that does not become narrow. It's the mercy of Allah cannot become narrow. Something that is great, grand, something that is very broad and big, you are trying to make it narrow. So immediately he understood that what I've just said is actually wrong. What I've said is wrong. It's like us when we pray sometimes, and this happens. My brothers and sisters, let's learn from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. You see, he had some enemies in Makkah, and even on the occasion of Ta'if, when he was able to ask Allah to destroy them, rather he made dua for their guidance. Rather, he made dua for their guidance. With us, small problem with our brother because we tried to buy something. I recall a real life example. I was once sitting in a motor vehicle with a certain brother a few years ago. He had just purchased a car. And a while later, he started saying, curse be upon this one and curse be upon that one. In the English language, he was actually uttering some bad words against a certain person. And I told him, but why? He said, he just sold me this car, but he cheated me. Okay. I told him, brother, it doesn't help. Make dua for his guidance so he doesn't cheat anybody else. Allahu Akbar. Because we make dua for the curse of someone, they make dua for our curse. We've seen that happening all along. Small problem you've had, just because your mother-in-law told you something, and at night you get up for tahajjud. Imagine, we get up for tahajjud only because I want to say, Ya Allah, that mother-in-law, just sort her out, Ya Allah. Imagine, tahajjud. Imagine. Why is that the relationship we have? Where is the peace in our own homes? The problem is when we call out to Allah, ask Allah for peace. Ask Allah, Ya Allah, grant me peace, grant her peace, grant her the ability, grant us all peace, and continue asking Allah. Because to be honest, the source of it is also connected to your supplication and your dua. If you are making a correct dua, it will result in your inner and outer peace. But when you are so angry within yourself, it shows in your dua. Allah knows that this person is so angry. Look at the type of dua they are making. These duas, they stem from anger and hatred sometimes. And this is why sometimes our du'as are not really heard as we want them to be heard. Subhanallah. This is why try and change the nature of your du'a. That is from the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He made a du'a for Abu Jahl and Umar ibn al-Khattab. At least one of them came through, subhanallah. He made a du'a in Taif that, oh Allah, when he was told we can crush these people. Listen to this. This is actually the epic of peace. The source, we say source of peace. Look at this. He was offered an offer by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the angels. That look, these two mountains that are here, these people that have beaten you, they have chased you, they have sent their children behind you to actually stone you, they have driven you right out, running out of that little city of Ta'if. We are offering you to bring together these two mountains and crush them. Straight. We are offering you to bring together the two mountains and to crush them. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam immediately, what do you think he did? Imagine if someone comes and bashes your motor vehicle. Not you. Someone bashes your motor vehicle and they went in and they reversed and they went in again and they reversed and they went in a third time. Minimum you'll say is, Ya Allah, destroy this person. That's the minimum. If you're a good person, I think you might get irritated. They were beating Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not his car or vehicle or something else. No, himself, until he was bleeding. And he says, Oh Allah, do not destroy them, because perhaps from their offspring there will be people who will accept my message. Guess what happened? A few years down the line, the entire Taif accepted Islam. The circumstances were a little bit different. It took a bit of a time and so on. But the fruit of it is, even today, if you go to Taif, you will find only Muslims, 100% Muslims. Same place, sometimes the same surnames that were there at the time, you hear them now as well. Thaqafi and so on, you hear it right now. Subhanallah, if you look at the power of that beautiful dua on the occasion when he was being offered to have something done that would only be a revenge, it wouldn't even be more than that. It would only be retaliation. He didn't start. He never ever initiated that war. No. It always came and he had to defend. Up to today, do you know what happens to Islam? Everyone just speaks bad about Islam. And what we do, we just keep on defending. No, that's wrong. No, this is wrong. Nobody's gone on to the offensive to say, do you know what? The other religions are like this, or the other people are like this, like that. Because it's not in our nature. We are not taught that as Muslimin. We are taught to project Islam. But the sad part of it is we sometimes are unfairly attacked, unduly attacked. People pick on us because of a few who might have done things that are un-Islamic, like we've mentioned earlier on. Some people misguided. Some people, they have gone into bad company. This is why ensure from an early age that your children are in good company. Watch the websites that they go to. Sometimes there are people behind that, you know, behind on the internet, behind the screen, who are actually brainwashing them to do dirty tricks and to do things that are not befitting a Muslim to start with. And we don't know where they got this type of thinking from. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. Like we say, do you know, my brothers and sisters, the non-Muslims out there? Wallahi, if you are used, the hadith says that if you are used to guide even one of them towards the deen, it's better for you than anything material you can ever have. How then can the same religion teach you that anyone who's out there, they are your enemies, you got to just kill them off? A'udhu billah. May Allah safeguard us from such deviance. That would defeat the whole purpose of Islam. Because myself and yourselves, some generations back, our forefathers or beyond were perhaps not Muslim. If that was the teaching of Islam, that you just eradicate anyone who's not a Muslim, how would they have accepted Islam? Such a simple question with such a logical answer. But now you have people who perhaps entered the fold of Islam as new Muslims, and because they've been conned into believing that, you know what, everyone who's not a Muslim is just your enemy, they now start doing things that are un-Islamic, and they've actually been hijacked by some form of agenda that some people are perhaps playing, which actually is against Islam. It has caused more damage to Islam than anything else. And we sometimes are struggling and suffering as a result of the actions of these few. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us and guide them. So my brothers and sisters, there is the example of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look at what he did. He says, oh Allah, guide these people, guide their children. If not them, at least their children will accept. And he went away. He was sad. He was very sad. So sad that he said, ya Allah, you placed on my shoulders the duty of giving them the message. They didn't even want to listen to the message. That's how weak I am. I'm so weak that these people did not even want to listen to my message. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala use us at least to deliver a good message. And can I inform you, the most powerful way of sharing the light that we have, the deen that we have, is to practice upon it. That's all. The most powerful way, without words, if you are a true Muslim, automatically you beam some form of tranquility from you. You beam some form of happiness, some form of contentment, some ruhaniyah. You have the spirituality about you that actually beams wherever you go, that even those who are not Muslim, they feel that there is something behind this person that is a driving force behind their contentment, subhanallah. And that alone is enough for them to start questioning, and they will find the answer. The problem is, when we don't live Islam, or we only pay lip service to it, people look at us, they want to become Muslims, but after seeing us, they turn away. They say, no ways. If this is the case, so nothing. You know, subhanallah, amazing. Allahu Akbar, may Allah protect us all. Sometimes you have a person who really chases people away from the deen. You know, in Islam, alcohol prohibited. In Islam, we know that gambling prohibited. We know the prohibitions. But sometimes you find Muslimin, you know, I know of one casino, and this is a reality. I know of one casino where I was told that there is a proper salah facility there. At the casino, it's a gambling block, complete. There is a salah facility of Muslim prayer. That can only be the case if a lot of the clients are actually Muslimin. Now, where is Islam? Do you think people who really know what Islam is and then went there would want to now become Muslimin after seeing that these people are not even practicing? This is why I call on you, my brothers and sisters, tonight. You want to make some good decisions, make them now. You don't know when your sand timer will run out of sand. Do you know that? You do not know when your sand timer will run out of sand. Let me explain to you what that means. When you're born, you have a sand timer. You know what the sand timer is? It's a little bit narrow in the middle with sand on one side. When you are born, it is turned. And the sand starts going. Your sand is limited. It's about to finish. Win your game. Score as many goals as you can. It's much more important. Imagine there's a little bit of sand, it's just going down. Let me quickly run and do this and do that and do that. When it's over, I'm gone. And I know, wow, I did the best I ever could. Mashallah, what a smile. Amazing. That is life. It's just like a sand timer. So remember, that sand timer is actually not going to stop. The sand is going down. And guess what? Have you ever watched a sand timer? I've watched it. When you're getting closer to the end, it seems for some reason that the sand is going faster. Have you noticed? Because it's not actually going faster, but it seems it's going faster. And the same applies with us, human beings. Your first few years in life are so full of different types of adventure, you know, adventurous years of your life. Once you clock a certain age, you like sort of calm down, you retire, you might be living for a few more years, but what would happen? Before you know it, you're gone. You're then known as grandpa. You know, they say grandpa, and I know of one man, he told his grandchildren, don't call me grandpa, call me daddy. Just because he wanted to feel young. That doesn't stop your sand timer. They can call you dad, they can call you son. Okay, no problem. We'll take it further. I call you son. Does that make you any younger? No, it doesn't. So remember, if you want to make decisions, make them now. This could be the last few grains of sand that are actually going down that sand timer of yours. Allahu Akbar. Make the decisions now. You want tawbah? Turn to Allah. Turn to Him now. You want to improve your dress code? Do it now. You want to turn to Allah? Turn to Him now. Don't wait. Don't wait. It's going to be too late. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. And remember one thing. Do not let the actions of some of us distract you from the beauty of this religion. No. There are people who might have actions that really distract us. We become so despondent because we see, look at these people. Sometimes even those who purport to be religious can be engaged in actions that are incorrect, actions that we are not proud of at all. Do not let that make you despair. You need to learn the deen from the correct source. The deen is full of peace. It is full of sympathy with others. It is full of goodness, reaching out, and the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The few examples that I've given you today, they are so powerful, and although they are very few, but you've got the gist of the message of Islam. We were talking of justice. Do you know that peace and universal peace, one of the main components I've already mentioned of is justice. Without justice, you cannot have peace. We spoke about Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu the day before yesterday. And I remember making mention of how Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, when he was lying under a tree and the ambassadors came through from elsewhere, they looked at him, they were shocked. This man who rules so much of the world, sleeping under a tree, no bodyguards, no nothing. You know what they said? They said, "Oh Umar, you were a ruler," meaning you ruled, given the opportunity of ruling, "and you were just. When you were just, you felt peace, at peace, secure, amint. You felt it secure. And when you felt secure, you were able to sleep under the tree." Subhanallah. Look at the skittle effect. It all goes back. He's sleeping under a tree because he's secure. He's secure because he was just. And he's just as a ruler. Subhanallah. What does he need to worry about? Look at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One day, there was a certain woman known as Fatima bint al-Makhzum from a very noble tribe who stole something. And she was about to be penalized. Now, to be penalized, the people looked at each other and said, "No man, she is the daughter of such a noble person. How can we penalize her?" So they said, "Let's hatch a plan." What's the plan? "Let's talk to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and explain to him that, look, you know what, just leave her for now, because you know what, she's the daughter of a very, very influential top person, and let's just leave her out." So they said, "Now how are we going to talk to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because we don't know how he's going to react?" So they decided, you know what, he's very close to this youngster. His name is Usama bin Zayd radiallahu anhu. Usama. So Usama bin Zayd radiallahu anhu was a young boy who grew up in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They spoke to him and they said, "You know what, why don't you talk to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and tell him that you see this Fatima bint al-Makhzum, she has, yes, committed this crime, but you know what, just let her go because she's from a very high, noble family. And if you are to penalize her, then you know there might be whatever, whatever, whatever." Subhanallah. He started his speech with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in such a beautiful way. And he tried, obviously, because he was so loved by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam heard a little bit of what he had to say and immediately uttered the famous words, "Atashfa'u fi haddin min hududillah?" Are you trying to come and intercede to me or here regarding this particular person? When it comes to the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you want some to be above and the other to be, you know, they say nobody should be above the law. Well, this is what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying. How can you want to come to me in order to let someone go off the law that is being applied of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He says, "Waymullahi, I swear by Allah, لو أن فاطمة بنت محمد سرقت لقطعت يدها." If it happened to be Fatima, not bint al-Makhzum, Fatima, daughter of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I would have penalized her. She would not be let off. Forget about you trying to tell me noble person, whatever. Even my own daughter would not be let off. No, if she did it, she did it. She needs to be penalized. Then he made the statement that I'd like to draw your attention towards. إِنَّمَا أَهْلَكَ مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ. Indeed, the reason why the nations before you were destroyed, the downfall of the nations before you were because أَنَّهُمْ كَانُوا إِذَا سَرَقَ فِيهِمُ الشَّرِيفُ تَرَكُوهُ وَإِذَا سَرَقَ فِيهِمُ الضَّعِيفُ أَقَامُوا عَلَيْهِ الْحَدِّ. He says, the reason why the previous nations dropped was because when the noble people committed crimes, they were let off. And when the povo committed crimes, they were penalized. So he says, nay, we as Muslims, if we would like to have peace, then a criminal is a criminal. Treat him as a criminal. And the one who is to be commended because of his honesty and so on, no matter who he is to be commended. And this is why in Islam, even those who have nothing, when they do a good deed, they are commended. They are commended. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not look at your body. He does not look at how good looking you are, how much wealth you have, and so on. He looks at your deeds and your heart. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. My brothers and sisters, it's been a lovely evening here. And mashallah, I really appreciate the fact that you've come here in large numbers. It is not the last time, inshallah, if Allah wills, it's not the last time that I will be here in KK. That's an easy way of saying it, mashallah. It's not the last time, inshallah, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I hope and I pray if Allah grants us the ability and if Allah accepts it from us to be here again and again, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to feel the bond that we have between us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to enhance the love that we have between us. Really, I feel so much at home, so much at ease with all my brothers and sisters here, mashallah. And to be honest with you, we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us in every single way, and to help us achieve internal peace by eradication of all the bad qualities that we may have, the qualities of jealousy and hatred and malice and deception and the other qualities such as backbiting and slandering and talking ill of others. Let's talk good about others. Let's say good things. Let's have good qualities, good feelings, inshallah. And remember one thing, turn to Allah. You will achieve both the peace of this world and the next. So if you turn to Allah, you will not only achieve the peace here, but you achieve the eternal peace as well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen us. Wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallahu bihamdih. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.
Tatibu liya al-haya wa urdi biha al-ilah yahlu al-wisal rahati. إن ضاقت كربتي توجهت لقبلتي.